Good morning, everyone, and thank you for coming. We're going to get started. My name is Laura Walton. I'm an educational assistant from Hastings and Prince Edward District School Board in Belleville, and I'm the president of CUPE's Ontario School Board Council of Unions, otherwise known as the OSBCU. My 55,000 coworkers and I are the frontline education workers who make Ontario's publicly funded schools run. We are the custodians, maintenance workers, and tradespeople who keep schools clean and in good repair. We are school secretaries, administrative assistants, audiovisual technologists, board office staff, and information technology specialists who provide supports necessary for the daily functioning of classrooms, IT infrastructure, cafeterias, gymnasiums, and auditoriums. We are educational assistants, early childhood educators, communicative disorder assistants, child and youth workers, nutrition services workers, library workers, school safety monitors, and social workers who protect students and nurture their creativity in the classroom. You name it, other than being a teacher or a superintendent, principal, or director, we do it all to give students at public, Catholic, English, and French schools the best learning experience we possibly can. And yet, we are paid only $39,000 a year on average. The majority of us personally subsidize Ontario's education system by doing unpaid work outside of regular hours because staffing levels are so low we cannot get all of the work done on paid time. On June 3rd, the day after the provincial election, we were the first group of workers to serve notice to bargain with Doug Ford's newly re-elected Conservative government. Today, the day before Premier Ford attends the swearing-in ceremony for his next cabinet, we're here to deliver 25,000 letters from frontline education workers all across the province to him. Writing directly to Premier Ford, my co-workers and I are calling for increased staffing in schools to guarantee that service improvements for students are in place for this September, as well as real wage increases above that of the rate of inflation to address low pay and problems that are happening with retention and recruitment. I want to read you just part of the letter to Doug Ford that over 25,000 frontline education workers have signed. Even before the pandemic, understaffing amongst education workers was a problem in Ontario's schools. Many school boards cannot recruit nor retain qualified education workers, in a large part because wages are so low and jobs are so precarious. During the COVID-19 pandemic, we have worked both in schools and off-site, at times risking our own and our families' health and safety. We took these risks so that students could keep learning, schools would be kept secure, and families and our communities had the support they needed. A 2021 survey of CUPE education workers found 51% of us work at least one additional job in order to make ends meet. This number increases to 64.5% if you are a sole income earner. Roughly 75% of our members are women, for whom the gender pay gap is widening further each year. I realize to most of you, this information about what education workers actually get paid and the actual work, extra work that we do subsidizing Ontario's public education system, the unpaid work at schools, the additional jobs to pay the bills, is probably surprising. I say it's probably surprising because it doesn't fit with some other important facts that we know about where we live and learn. We know that Ontario is the richest province in one of the wealthiest nations on earth. That according to Oxfam Canada, the fortunes controlled by only 59 Canadian billionaires have increased by more than $100 billion during the pandemic, roughly the same amount as was spent by the Canadian government on COVID-19 income supports to workers, including CERB and CRB. That the richest 41 Canadian billionaires have the same wealth as the bottom 40% of us. In other words, they have the same amount of money as 15 million people. For context, 15 million is about the population of Ontario. How does this extreme wealth controlled by the few translate into the reality experienced by the rest of us? what students, their caregivers, and education workers experience in Ontario schools every day? Well, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives has calculated that the Ford government cut education funding by $800 per student, adjusted for inflation, over its first term. With 2 million students in Ontario schools, that equals a $1.6 billion funding cut by the Ford government in the 2021-2022 school year alone. This is money that could, never mind could, but should be used to improve supports for students, increase staffing levels, raise the wages of education workers so that we don't have to live in poverty or with the threat of it dangling over our heads. This is the way it is now, but as my co-workers say in their letters to Doug Ford, it doesn't have to be this way. Right now, not enough education workers means students don't have the services and supports that they need. For example, 60% of educational assistants support five or more students each day, and less than 8% only work with one student. Every student, including students with special needs, should have EA support should they need to develop to their full potential. Right now, kids do without supports of children and youth workers, of psychologists and social workers, and other professionals. But every student should have the support they need at school to thrive. Right now, there is no provincial standard for school cleanliness or maintenance, and work doesn't get done because there's simply not enough custodians and caretakers to do it. But every school board custodian and caretaker should have enough co-workers to make sure their school is up to standard, and that every maintenance worker should have the resources to address a $16.8 billion repair backlog. Premier Ford and the current Education Minister Stephen Lecce and the whole PC government have the power to give students the supports and services needed to recover from the pandemic and to thrive in their school communities. This government has the power to come to the table and negotiate real wage increases above the rate of inflation, to address low pay and retention difficulties, and to make up for the past wage suppression. The 83 members of provincial parliament who will sit next to and behind Premier Ford and Minister Lecce on the government side of the legislature, each of them has the power to stop cutting corners on our children's future. To sum up, I want to be crystal clear. For the government policymakers who I know are diligently taking notes as they watch this news conferences in their office, we're calling on you, Premier Ford, to write in writing to us at the bargaining table, provide the funding necessary for high quality, second to none, publicly funded, publicly delivered education that Ontario families expect and deserve, including real wage increases above inflation to address wage inequality, past wage suppression and the recruitment and retention of frontline education workers, and increased staffing to ensure that all students, in particular students with special needs, have the supports that they need at school. To be frank, parents, students, communities, and education workers can no longer wait. I want to thank you for listening to me this morning. My co-workers and I appreciate you reporting on our efforts to make schools and this province better for everyone. I'm happy to take questions. It's been a long time since we've had to do this, right?
Yeah. I mean, how are you feeling about the possibility of having those fruitful discussions based on what you've heard from Premier Ford and from Stephen Lecce so far?
So listen, last night, Monty McNaughton, you know, said that he has the back of every worker and he's out to make sure that everyone has a better paycheck. We're holding him to it. It's time to get to the bargaining table. You can't tweet this. You actually have to take action and you have to get to the bargaining table. And we know that we have workers that are building power and are going to be ready to hold them accountable. You know, talk is cheap. It's time to put it in writing.
What is holding accountable, holding people like Monty McNaughton or other members of the government accountable look like?
I think it's being active. It's watching folks that typically, you know, have not had a voice and providing them space. Every single letter that we're providing today represents a conversation that happened with a worker, including those workers that often don't agree with us. And that's okay, because what we're hearing is, regardless of stripe, regardless of, you know, what their belief system is, they know that their wages have been suppressed by governments and they are demanding better and they're ready to fight for it. And they're ready to fight to ensure that the kids that rely on us have the services they need. It's time for this to be frontline news.
Does fighting for it mean reintroducing the possibility of striking again?
So strikes aren't made just by a union, right? Strikes happen when employers and governments, you know, refuse to budge as well. So all of this can be avoided. There's, you know, to quote, once upon a time we had an education minister who said there's a long time before Labor Day. And I don't often quote someone like that, but I'm going to today. We have a lot of time. We're ready. We have called on them. We have provided an open schedule. Let's get to the table. Let's get this done.
Andrea Williams, CBC French. We've never met before.
Hi.
I was wondering, do you have a specific like targets or numbers in terms of hiring more people, wages? You said increase in wages that surpass inflation, but do you have like specific numbers?
Yeah, I think we have to be looking at it. I mean, if you asked me this question 2 weeks ago, it was before we found out that inflation is up by 7% this month. So, you know, it's constantly moving. But I think what's really important to recognize is that the workers that we represent have lost 11% of their wages in the last decade. We just heard a story of someone who lost their partner. They passed away and they are unable to remortgage the family home because their wage does not qualify them for that. So they will be forced to leave their family home because of the very low wages that education workers experience. That is not acceptable.
Hi. So my first question is, following the election, are you expecting a different tone from the government?
You know, following the election, I would hope that this government would recognize that over the past 2 years, education workers have been on the front line. They have been in schools. They have been there. Most of our workers were back within a week of when the pandemic was first declared. I think it's time to recognize what has gone on in the past 2 years, and it's time to work together. I spent the last 4 years with a government that refused to speak to us, and I'm calling on them now. You know, we have said, Ford came out and said, let's get it done. We're holding him to it. And that's going to take collaboration, whether they like it or not.
And the relationship between the education minister, Stephen Lecce, and the unions having contentions. The cabinet's going to be revealed tomorrow. Do you want to see Stephen Lecce having that same job tomorrow when we find out the cabinet position?
So I've only ever met with Stephen Lecce once in his entire career as the education minister. So whoever the education minister is, I hope they recognize that real collaboration is more than a soundbite. It's actually having ongoing conversations with them, not by folks that work in the ministry, but with them directly.
And just finally, QP already sent their letter of intent to bargain to the government. And the government, there is reporting that the government said that they need a little more time to actually respond to those letters. Is there a little wiggle room to allow the government to really respond to those letters because we were coming off an election?
So we met with the government and the Council of Trustees Association on Friday. It was really disappointing. You know, the first meetings are always about what is the scope of negotiations. The scope has been in existence for 8 years. They were unable to agree to a document that's been in existence for 8 years. They also were not willing to agree to the fact that we weren't interested in a media blackout. And so neither of those things require, you know, an election happening earlier. But I would remind folks that the date of bargaining is actually set by a law, right? It's legislation. So it should come as no surprise that, you know, it was time to bargain. And surely to goodness, some pre-planning would have avoided the need to delay.
Well, my colleague kind of touched on it, but I wanted to maybe hear a little bit more about how you've been, what your exchanges with the government have been like in the past years, the tone of the conversations, how you've been received by the government, but you said they refused to talk to you.
So I have had one in-person meeting with Stephen Lecce, and I've had one phone call with Stephen Lecce. So I really don't think it's enough for me to comment on the tone or capacity of that. I do welcome whoever becomes the education minister tomorrow. I welcome. It's time to talk to workers. There is no such thing as the union. The union is all of these workers, right? And so it's time to have those conversations and recognize that as workers, we represent what families and communities and students need. To divide us from that is foolish.
Yannick Lepage, CBC Radio Canada. You mentioned not wanting to go on strike, at least at the moment. What is the next step if the government doesn't bring this issue forward?
Well, I think we need to get to the bargaining table. To start talking about strike before you start bargaining is not a wise move any more than, would we be asking the question of the Council of Trustees Association and the government if they were going to lock out workers? I think we need to have the table and we need to have these really good discussions. But let's be clear, recruitment and retention is an employer issue. They know that we need to pay people more money in order to get them to take these jobs. So hopefully that will come across in what is proposed from across the table.
Are you expecting another meeting, maybe a phone call with the next education minister before going to the table?
It would be great if we had one when the cabinet was declared, a chance to reach out and say, hey, this is who we are. I think that would be wonderful, and we're open to have that conversation at that time. Thank you.